Hey guys, what's up? I'm Rashmi Kiran Pandit from ASIM Student Chapter IIT ISM, and I welcome you all to the very first session of Hour of Code 2021. And to make this event even more special, we have with us a very esteemed guest, Mohtan Sarkar Ma'am. She is a cybersecurity expert and cybercrime investigator with a work experience of 9 years in cyber forensic. She has worked with esteemed organizations such as CID, CFSL, and SVP, National Police Organization. And today she will be throwing light on the field of cybersecurity, will be sharing her experiences and guiding you all on how to get started in this amazing field. Also, towards the end of this session, we will be taking your queries and doubts. So make sure you go and ask your questions in the live chat below. So without any further ado, let's get started. All over to you, ma'am.
Thank
you, Rashmi.
Welcome
you to this panel. Yeah, you can start now.
Thank you, Rashmi. Very happy New Year to everyone. So you all can see my screen? All of you can see my screen? Rashmi, is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible. We can see your screen now.
Okay. So let's get started. You know, it's in fact a challenge for me after 3 o'clock to give a session at 3 o'clock. I knew you all might be having a lavish lunch and very drowsy and lazy. But cybersecurity, cybercrime is a very exciting field. So I know it's going to be very exciting and interesting. So cybercrime case studies. So, you know, you all are in your engineering and BTech. So you all get ranks, CGPA percentage. So, you know, the higher the rank, the higher, the more talented a person is, or that is how the more percentage you get, that is how your skills have been judged. So in crime, what is a perfect crime? You know, any crime which is delayed, which gets the detection delayed, is a perfect crime. So cybercrime is the perfect crime because detecting cybercrime or analyzing cybercrime is actually very difficult. So let's get started. So coming to cybercrime, what is cybercrime? So any crime where a laptop, mobile phone is used as a crime, in a crime is a cybercrime? Yes. So for example, my younger sister hits me with her laptop on my head and I get really injured. So I go to the police station and I lodge a complaint against my sister that, sir, can you please take a cybercrime against her because she has used her laptop to hit me? Because what I agreed is any crime where a laptop or a mobile phone is used is a cybercrime. No, right? So what is a cybercrime? Any crime where ESI is involved is a cybercrime. ESI is your electronically stored information. So any crime where ESI is involved is a cybercrime. So coming to what are the types of cybercrime? So computer targeted crime. Any crime where a computer is a target or a mobile phone is a target. No, we all are doing our coding and all. You know, you don't have to be a developer or a very big coder. You know, you just have to write small codes. I write a malware. Just a three-liner batch file. The first line is whenever my machine is switched on. Second line is it should restart and I put it in the loop. So when the machine is on, it should go and restart and I put this in the loop. So it's just a three-liner code. So whenever this malware is installed, anybody's laptop. So once they switch on the laptop, it will keep on restarting and then again restart and again restart because it's in loop. So a small three-liner can completely destroy your laptop. So any a small malware I have installed in somebody's laptop where that laptop is a computer targeted crime, where I have targeted somebody's laptop. So that target is my victim. So this is where computer targeted crime. The second one is computer assisted crime. For example, I have to attend a job interview and I don't have enough marks or good marks to attend that interview. So what I do, I take my certificate, I scan it, I alter my marks. I'm just a mediocre student, so I alter my marks And then I use Photoshop to change the marks. And then I attend the interview. So here, my computer, my printer, my scanner, my Photoshop software, they all have assisted me in committing a crime. So this is where computer assisted crime. Here, all these things, computers, printers, softwares are suspect in the crime. So your fake currencies, fake certificates, all these are computer assisted crime. The next is your computer is incidental to the crime, where I am sending a threatening message from my WhatsApp to your WhatsApp, where both the phones and both the apps are witnesses. So here, both the devices are witness to the crime, and they would be provided as evidence in the court of law to prove my guilt or prove that somebody is a victim. So here, the device. Cyber crimes, victim, suspect, and witness. Coming to WhatsApp, there's a lots of noise in the outside in the media about the WhatsApp privacy policies. We'll have a look at that at the end of the session. So what exactly the privacy changes are and what issues they have made. So let me complete with the cybersecurity, then I'll come to the privacy thing. So now, changing nature of crime. You know, as and well, I keep on speaking about cybersecurity, I'll also tell you my experiences in this. Let me tell you that today I am very proud that I'm giving a session in IIT because I myself have failed in my joint entrance examination. So I'm very sure that you all are much more talented than I am. And when I was in my first year or second year of engineering, I was very poor with coding. Java, C, .NET, C++, Visual Basics. I could hardly remember any of the logic. Chicks in the code. I used to mug up my codes, and I used to go for my practical exams and written exams. But then how did I end up in cybersecurity? So I was very poor in coding. So, you know, we have our internships where you have to be really good with your codes and all codes. So I know any corporate company will not give me internship without knowing developing language. But I was doing my engineering and information technology. Then I got an idea that why can't I go to ethical hacking? I have to be just good with tools, not with codes. And that is how my career in cybersecurity started. So coming to changing nature of crime, what happened 8,000 years before? 8,000 years before, it was Stone Age man. That time, humans used to take heavy stones, sharp stones, and kill fellow humans or fellow humans. So crime was committed using stones. That was in Stone Age period. Later, 2000 years back was Iron Age man. That time iron arrows, iron spears was made, and that was used as a weapon. 14th century came the Industrial Revolution. That time we had guns, cannons, and other industrially produced weapons. 21st century. What happened in 21st century? Your bits and bytes have replaced the bullets. So bullets are old-fashioned now. Now everything is done by bits and bullets. So you have your ransom attack. Ransomware. You know, you all might be aware of Petya, WannaCry. You know, every third day a new ransomware comes out. So if my grandfather asks me what is a ransomware, so surely I will not go and try to explain him what is encryption, what is decryption, what is blockchain, bitcoins. I would just simply say, what is a kidnapping case? What was a kidnapping case at your time? Is a ransom attack there? Because of my negligence, my data got encrypted. My data got kidnapped. And because my data got kidnapped, now those people have my data. And just to release my data, they are asking me for some ransom, for some amount, for some money. And just the way earlier they used to ask to come to an unknown location with a bag of money and drop it here. Similarly, they want to keep the amount, the receiver, anonymous. So they are demanding it in bitcoins. So ransomware is our typical conventional kidnapping case. So this is how the nature of crime is changing. So 21st century is your bits and bytes. Now, tell me, where did the nuclear power stage go? I have spoke about Stone Age, Iron Age, Industrial Revolution, Digital Revolution. Now, where is nuclear power plants? There are 10 countries in the world with nuclear power plants, power weapons, but why haven't I mentioned them over here? So let me tell you, nuclear power plants are being managed by computers. They are managed by SCADA systems, PLC, or programmable logic control. So you might be very well aware of Stuxnet. Stuxnet is a deadly worm. What happened in Iran? Iran's nuclear power plant was attacked. Just like this, we have Hour of Code. We have many seminars going on around. There was a seminar. There was a conference for international conference with all the scientists in the world. They all came for a 5-day conference and they shared their knowledge. There were guest speakers. There were esteemed scientists. And at the very fifth day, they give you goodies. They give you coffee mugs, those bags filled with your study materials, books, DVDs, pen drives, as a takeaway where all the study materials have been loaded and all. So similarly, a new pen drive was given as a goodie. So the scientist at Iran's nuclear power plant, he attended the conference and then got back to his office. Later, when he opened his pen drive and just inserted it in his office computer, that was the deadliest mistake he did. What happened? The moment he opened his brand new pen drive and inserted in the office computer, there was a worm already installed in that pen drive. It has reduced the, you know how nuclear power plants run this centrifugal, the turbines rotate, and then the nuclear fission takes place. So there a code was written where the worm was very difficult. The worm was designed in such a way that it would not get detected by the firewall or any other antivirus, and it kept on changing itself, and then it had completely shut down the nuclear power plant of Iran. So in news, and because it was Iran's nuclear power plant, there was obvious allegations that Israel might have done that, or it was Israel's strategy to shut down the nuclear power plant of Iran. But then later, maybe after 2 years, there was a media report that it was a joint mission of US and Israel both. So this is how you can how deadly digital age has become. We had World War One, World War Two. Now it is going to be cyber warfare. So now, what is the takeaway from here? Anyone, New Year gift, Christmas gift, you are getting any mobile phones, a hard disk, laptop, you're not supposed to take such devices as gifts, because you never know what kind of spywares or malwares or other things it is loaded with. Let me tell you, just as you all are in college now, during my time when I was in college, say 8 years back, when I was doing my engineering, that time it was those small phones, your Nokia, or your Sony phones, Sony Ericsson, Nokia. That time, any guy or any girl had a smartphone, a touch phone. So we used to think, okay, this guy might be, or this girl might be a big shot. He has a smartphone with him. He might be very rich or comes from a big family. We used to think that way. But now when I'm in the field of cybersecurity and I go to conferences or I go to other organization and I really see some guy with a small phone, the 1100 torchlight phone, then I see, oh my God, this guy is having a black and white phone. He might be a really great shot. He might be a classified person. He might be this agent, or might be he works for RAW. Now the smaller the phone you are, that means you are so important that your information is to be kept safe from all the devices. That's the reason you are using a black and white phone, because you know how vulnerable our data is. Nowadays relationships are online, so every photo you take on your phone is actually not in your phone, it's there in all the servers, and where not, you'd never know. So nothing is private. The word private is a myth now. So let me tell you who are the actors of cybersecurity, like who commits the cyber crimes. State support intelligence agencies. Chinese government has already declared that they have 180,000 cyber commandos. Just the way India is having Air Force, Navy, Air Force, and Army. Army is securing the land, Air Force is securing the sky, and Navy is securing our waterways. Similarly, Chinese government has openly declared they have 180,000 cyber commandos who are trying to secure the cyberspace. They just make sure that there is no attack on Chinese cyberspace, and simultaneously they try to attack the cyberspace of other enemy countries. So we have states support intelligence agencies, cyber commandos. Most of the countries have this. They may openly accept it or may not accept it, but you know, it's coming up. It's now defense is no more restricted to air, land, and waterways. We apart from army, navy, air force, we have cyber commandos. Next is the hacktivist and terrorist. You know, every terrorist every terrorist organization has their own websites. You know, the funding, the recruitment of terrorists. You know, everything happens online. You know, they just like us, you know, they have their Naukri.com and LinkedIn, Monster.com. So what happened? Al-Qaeda had its own website. What they did, Al-Qaeda in their website was had videos of making rocket launchers and hand grenades. They showed complete video how can you use those wires and circuits and all make rockets, those small rockets. You know, it will be in your back and it just launches up. How do you make it with your household things and with normal the minimum goods? So those videos. So what MI6? We all know MI6, the secret service, secret intelligence services, SIS. So MI6 is UK secret intelligence services. So they have hacked into Al-Qaeda's website and they have removed those rocket making and bomb making videos and replaced it with recipes of cupcakes and cakes. So this is how, maybe for a good reason, but they could hack into the servers of Al-Qaeda and replace the videos. The next category of committers are competitors. You know, suppose Amazon is giving some big billion day offer, so Flipkart will have a team which will try to get down the site of their competitors down, or Myntra might try to do something. So competitors, every company nowadays have a team working on this cybersecurity, how to protect their network, how to attack other network. The fourth category is disgruntled employees. Now suppose I work for TCS, and now after 2 months is my appraisal. So I work for TCS. I work for 12 to 14 hours every day. Maybe after 2 months, my manager says that, Mohtan, we can't give you much hike this year because you have not put enough effort. You please work hard this year. Next year, we'll try to make sure that you get a good hike. But after working for 12 hours, 14 hours, this is how my manager is talking to me. I don't want to work anymore in this company. I just want to walk out of this company and get a new job. So what I do, I have put so much of effort, but I know what I'll be doing. I'll be just erasing off all the servers. I will removing all the databases and whatever work or whatever access I have, I'll try to misutilize all those things and wipe out things. So these are another category of disgruntled employees in in aggression. I do a lot of things which I'm not supposed to do. And the fifth category is script kiddies. Now, this is one more dangerous category. You know, NASA's website was hacked by a 14-year-old kid. Pentagon, the world's most guarded place, was hacked by a 12-year-old kid. You know, when FBI came knocking to their house, like from this IP address, files are getting transferred from Pentagon to this. So just knocked the house. When the parents opened, where is your son? He said he's playing a computer game. But then when they searched his laptop, they found lot of files, confidential files over there. So you know, these are all the things. So you know, something starts at home. You know, we just have your online exams. You know, you just make sure, you know, you just have to make sure how do you get access to your exams and maybe get the site down or get the answers out. So everything starts with that small slight of curiosity or that small shortcut you're looking for. So this is how everything gets a start. Studies. So maybe I'll come to it later. So you can tell me, what is this? Which plant is this? I'm not getting your chats. Rashmi, where are they posting the answers or any chats?
Ma'am, they have still not posted anything. Ma'am, if they post anything, I will let you know.
All right.
I'll let you know.
So which plant or which leaves are this? So let me tell you, you know, there was a couple of years back, I was working for SOC. What is SOC? Security Operations Center. SOC is like every company or any other company, every company will have a command center, which looks like your police control room, where, you know, the walls are filled with monitors and, you know, every network, you know, the firewall, the malware intelligence tool, your email. Security tool or every tool is showing their alerts in the screen in the command center. You sit there and you analyze if anything is trying to attack your computer or any data from your organization, any employees trying to put that out. So all this analysis is done in a security operations center. So, you know, if any employees trying to do something, we have to rely, we have to check with the policies of that organization and work on that. So similarly, there was one flower ordering shop. So, you know, people, you know, New Year is coming, 14th Feb is coming. We all love to send flowers and gifts, chocolates, cakes to our loved ones. So there was one flower selling site. So there was a normal flower selling site and it was being showing as an alert in my machine. So just my colleague told me, Motan, there's a flower selling site somewhere in the European countries and it's just showing is as an alert. Can you please go check it out? Then he said that maybe it's a case of a false positive. We all know what's a false positive. There are times where, you know, it's actually not a malware, but then the tool takes it as a malware and gives us a false alert or a false positive case. So, okay, he said me that, Motan, please have a look at this. It's a flower selling site. You'll enjoy it. You just have a look at all the flowers and just mark it, whitelist it. Maybe it's a false case or false positive. Then I was just going through the price of all the flowers and bouquets. And then I noticed this kind of flower was being sold in that site. And this particular flower was very costly. The very moment I got to know that this is not a flower, this is cannabis. What you call marijuana, or in Hindi we call ganja. So this is your cannabis and this is a drug. So, you know, in as per those, that company I was working for, there was a policy like employees cannot browse into drugs site or weapons site or dating apps. They are not supposed to do all these things. So that was the reason. It was a normal, simple website selling flowers with all the securities, but there was at some corner along in the middle of all the flowers, it was selling cannabis, which is a drug and which is not legal. So, you know, there are small things, you know, you don't have to be very sure on cybersecurity. Cybersecurity is a field where not only technology, you have to be clear with the technology, you have to be knowing the laws of the land, the country you are in, or maybe internationally, you have to be knowing the laws. So cybersecurity is the field where you have to be sure with the technology, law, and psychology. It's not always technology can crack the cases. You know, many a times, maybe I'm not a very technical person, I'm not a very technical girl, but just by psychologically, I can just analyze the thing. I have to be having certain knowledge on legal aspects, the IT laws. Here we have Information Technology Act, amended 2008. And then psychology, technology, and legal law. So all these three things will together make you a cybersecurity expert or a cybercrime investigator, or maybe someday a CIO of a company or CISO. So what is this? This is your 26/11. What happened on 26/11? The Mumbai attack. All the places, Nariman Point, Taj Hotel, Kama Hospital, Chhatrapati Shivaji Terminus, you know, all German bakery, lot of points have been attacked. What we have noticed, the 3-day long attack, when the terrorists was in Taj Hotel, you know, they were constantly in touch with their what you call masters, Aka, back to our neighboring countries. What happened there? You know, they were people sitting across the borders were giving them clear-cut instructions. You go to this room, you know, hostages are hiding in this room. You go to that corner, that floor. How were they able to say, predict people sitting across the borders so accurately that you have to go there, and go here? That is where people are. And this was also very well planned. terrorists were not using their phones to call the people across the borders to the people in our neighboring country. They took the phone of the hostage. They took the phone of the hostage and gave a missed call to some number in Austria. Then from there, VoIP, voice over internet protocol, arrived and it landed to that country, because, you know, at times VoIPs are very difficult to analyze. So that is what. So now the question was, how did they hack into the CCTVs? Now, Internet of Things have come. Internet of your things, your washing machine is a smart machine, your television is a smart machine, your phone. I'm sure everyone might have watched the movie Die Hard 4. Every device is a smart device. So not necessarily you don't have to hack my laptop or hack my phone to get my personal details or get all information out of me. You can just hack the washing machine, which is a smart device, and get into my laptop and get into my phone. So every device. So what happened in Taj? Did they hack the CCTV? No, it was expected that this might have happened. But what happened is all thanks to Indian media. It was Indian media who was telling that, you know, people are here, people are there. And those people were following Indian media and giving instructions to the terrorists who were inside the Taj Hotel that go here, go there. So all thanks to the media over there. So again, one more point, you're not supposed to make all your personal life public. For example, I was having a talk with Rashmi. So maybe she is a friendly girl, she's a jolly girl. Maybe I speak for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and we have that good rapport. And then maybe we text with each other. Maybe after 2-3 days, we started talking. And then fourth day, I go to a Facebook profile and I just go and click on forget password. What happens? If I go and click on forget password, I'll be getting 2 to 3 security questions. What is her first school? What is her first pet's name? What is her maiden name? You know, social engineer. Like, I have become so friendly that I have got most of her informations out of with her. And now I know most of her informations and I can also crack her accounts just by answering the security questions. So it is very important that everywhere, every profile, you activate the two-factor authentication, MFA, multiple factor authentication, so that anytime anyone is trying to do anything, you get an alert over there. Now, this is one more case, Control H. You know, again, I'm telling you, you know, it's okay that if you are techie, that's well and good. If you are not a techie, then also you can become a cybercrime investigator. You know, we need people. We need people in forensic. We need cybercrime investigators. We need those technical minds in the market. There's a huge demand of people in cybersecurity. But there's a gap between the university and the industry, you know, that we need to fill it up. So what happened? It was a case of Delhi police, where a girl was missing from very long. A girl was missing and we were not trying to trace her back. So when Delhi police was trying to find her out, they went and asked the parents, do you suspect anyone, or you think that where might your girl have gone? But they didn't suspect anyone. And there was police was clueless about it. Then what happened? After 10 days, the mother of the girl said that there was a guy in the neighborhood, just 29 years old guy. So I just suspect on him, but there are not serious clues. We don't have any evidence or anything, but we just suspect him. Then finally, what happened? The police got that guy, asked him, do you know that girl? He said, no, she's a school-going girl and I don't know anything about her. And when I used to be in my balcony, I just saw her crossing and all. That's all she said. Then after 1 week, Delhi police came to that guy's house. They searched his laptop and they took away his laptop. What happened there? In his laptop, they didn't use any forensic tool or any other tool. What happened there? They just did Control H. They just checked the history of the browsing. They just checked the browsing history. So what did he check in his browsing history? He just checked what happens, how to drown a dead body. We all know if you have life in yourself, the life body will drown in water and a dead body will float in water. So that guy had checked how to drown a dead body, because dead please float in water. And then that is how the police got a clue. And then they started searching all the nearby water bodies in and around Delhi. And then within 2 days, they have got the dead body of that girl. And they have taken that guy. That is, they have taken that guy into custody. So just a simple control H has solved the complete murder mystery. Now, we all do browsing in incognito mode, right? We think if we browse in incognito mode, everything is safe. But that is not the case. What happens, you know, there's always a big boss who is watching on us. All your data is under surveillance. Whatever you do, when internet is connected, everything is going everywhere. So you are never secure. What happens if you do go to incognito mode and browse? In that case, out of 10,000 searches, there is only 500 people who are doing it incognito mode. So for the big bosses over there, it is easier to them to for them to understand who is doing what they are not supposed to do. So from 10,000, they will first analyze this 500 people and then they will come to know. So anything which you do in internet is actually not safe and secure. Now coming to banking fraud, what is banking? The classiest frauds is the banking frauds over here. So I'll just give you a quick example. There was a German bank. The manager of that bank was getting best customer friendly manager award from last 3 years. Now what happened? We have certain habits, certain patterns of nature. So I get my salary on 1st of every month. So I'll be very active from first 10 days. I got my salary. I want to do this shopping. I want to do my New Year party shopping. I want to do this, that. And first 10 days, I'm very active. But it may be from 15th to 25th of every month, I'm not very active. But from the last 5 days also, I'm running out of money. So I have to go to my bank and get some cash out, or I want to do something. So this bank manager was getting the best customer friendly award from 3 years. Now what happened? All of a sudden, there was a customer who came back to the police and reported that I have got a lot of money in my bank. So generally in India, this will never happen, that if somebody is getting a lot of money, they will go and complain to the police. They just keep quiet and get all the money. In fact, they would not even tell it to their near and dear ones, saying that, okay, nazar lag jayegi. But what happened? Any banking application is a code of maybe 50,000 lines or 80,000 lines. What happened in this 50,000 lines? The bank manager has inserted just 2 lines of code. He said that every 10 days of a month from every account, only the interest. You know, we have our savings account, we have fixed deposit. We hardly bother how much interest we are getting in the savings account. So for 10 days, just the saving, the money was 60% of the money was getting transferred to the bank manager. Then he will just take the interest and return the principal amount back. So from every account, he is getting some point percentage of savings. So that, and he had lakhs of customers in that account. So if he takes even 10 rupees from lakhs of customers, so it is a very huge money. So this guy, the name of the bank manager was Ziegler. The name of the bank manager is Ziegler. So what Ziegler was doing is he was taking the interest rate from every customer and making a huge money. Just 2 lines of codes. The first line said from this date to that date, 60% of the money would go to his account and then again it will come back. So the interest would only get deposited over there. So with these 2 lines of code, he was earning a huge lot of money. If at all any customer would find out how his money is missing, then he will go and complain. Then he will say, okay, there's some error or there's something, and he would transfer the money back. That is the reason he was getting the best customer friendly award from last 3 years. But now there was a customer and Ziegler was the last customer of the bank. So the code was written that to the last customer. But then when this person Ziegler came up, Z-Y-G-L-E-R, he became the last customer and then he got all the money. And just because of this thing, you know, the whole case came into picture just because the analyzer have to investigate 50,000 codes. So now, you know, when you are coding, how you should be coding it, it should be hard coded so that there are not such incidents coming up in the future. Now coming to social engineering case, what is social engineering? You know, Most of the cybersecurity experts might be telling you you need to have a firewall in your network, you need to have an antivirus in your phone, antivirus in your laptop. And yeah, please note, not a free antivirus. You never know, the free antivirus is already coming with the virus. Maybe your free antivirus is already loaded with a spyware or an adware or a malware. So you should try to get a paid version of antivirus. So social engineering, before you check on the security, before you have antivirus to your laptop or to your phone, you have to make sure your mind is hard proofed. Your mind has been having a firewall. We all are emotional beings. We all tend to trust people. And you all being very young, let me tell you, please don't get trapped into those dating sites. You have Truly Madly, you have Tinder. I think you can better tell me what all latest dating apps are available. So you are not supposed to get trapped over there. So, you know, we all are human beings. We all are emotional. You know, anyone speaks sweetly, we tend to trust people. Rashmi gave an introduction to me that I have worked for CID, for NPA. What all she said, you all trusted, right? You don't know, have I really worked or not? So those are, don't blindly trust people, don't blindly trust strangers, and don't blindly trust people, especially who are on the other side of your phone or on the other side of your laptop. You all might be aware of Jamtara. Yes, Jamtara is the cybercrime capital of the country. It's a small village. It's a small village, Jamtara. If you go to the police station of that village, the main occupation of that village is agriculture. You know, 90% people of there are farmers. But if you go to that police station, you will find 72 inches ka television. You will find leather sofa set. You will find 2-3 Scorpios, 22 air conditioners, and whatnot. It's a very high end police station. What happens in Jamtara? They just run customer care calls. Ma'am, I'm calling from SBI Bank. If you have to link your Aadhaar card to your account, you don't have to come to your office. You just have to give your Aadhaar card number and we will send you our OTP. You have to just confirm it. Or, you know, a lot of cases, the only thing they know is they just know how to talk. So just by making calls, it's a small village, but if you see, go to that village, you will find just 32 towers, mobile phone towers are there, because, you know, every second there are thousands of calls generating from that village. I'm sure, you know, maybe after completing your BTech or after completing your graduation, many of you would be trying for your civil services or UPSC. So there were two guys who went for getting trained in UPSC, but they couldn't. But now they earn a lot of money. Maybe they would not have earned over there just by hacking into people's account and getting money. And they also run just the way you have RC Reddy or Byju's, Braintree, you know, for civil service coaching. They also have ATM classes. In ATM classes, they will just train you how to talk like a customer care and how to dupe person. One will talk and the other will be duping. They have you know, maybe after the session, just go and Google it to Jamtara. I think there's a Netflix series also around it. You can have a look. You will get to know what all happens over there. But then, you know, if I ask you which is the best university of the country, maybe you will say IIT, or maybe somebody will say IIIT, or then you have this university. But I would say the best university in the country is the University of Prison. In IIT, maybe I learned 10. I do 10 projects in my 4 years of thing. I work with 3 professors and I do 10 projects. Maybe in my office and TCS, every year I do 1 project. Maybe next year my project changes. But so my learning is 1 project per year. Or maybe in IIT you learn 10 projects in 4 years. But what happens in a prison? University of Prison. You know, in a prison there are 200 mates. Inmates. So this person will say, you know, I did this. Maine ye kya, this isliye main pakda gaya. I have done this. That is the reason police could track me out. I have done this mistake by making this call. That is how I'm caught. So when an inmate is out from a prison, he knows 200 more ways to bypass police. So guys, here, you know, whatever you learn, try to share among your peers. You know, you have a guest speaker, you have conferences, you have your professors, you have a state of the art library, but the only thing you learn is from your peers. You don't learn from all these places. You learn from your peers. So keep sharing whatever you have learned. Keep talking to each other. So that is how you will learn. And social engineering skills, you know, what do you call suspects or our criminals are always two steps ahead from our investigators. So many a times we learn from them. There are instances when we have learned social engineering tricks from them. I have already spoken to Rashmi. This session has been streamed online. So maybe there are certain restrictions. I may not be speaking. So there are cases where we have learned from that and implied it on them itself. So coming to next, what is this? What is this? Which flower is this? You can just post it in the chat. I'll go through the chats. Is my audio not visible? Am I not audible? Sorry. Am I not audible? I can see some messages that audio is not clear. Rashmi, you can hear me clearly?
Yes, ma'am. Your voice is clear, but it's cracking a bit. We can hear you clearly, but it's cracking a bit, but that's not a big issue. It's okay.
All right. We'll go back to the presentation. So what is this? Which flower is this? So which flower is this? A lot of technical talk, right? We need some relaxation in between the presentations. So this is a Christmas orchard. The header says that. So it has a spur. This spur is 20 to 35 centimeters long. So it's a Christmas orchard. It's a native of Madagascar. And the spur is 20 to 35 meters long. So why, what's so special about this flower? So what are your thoughts on this? So coming to here, so Charles Darwin, we all know Charles Darwin, the father of evolution. Charles Darwin, in his book called Fertilization of Orchids, he said that if a flower is having a spur which is 25 centimeters long, there has to be a moth with a proboscis. There has to be a moth with the proboscis 30 centimeters long. So only then, if this moth exists, only then there can be fertilization of this orchid. Right? So what Charles Darwin said was discovered, what he wrote in this book, Fertilization of Orchids, was discovered 41 years later. This Fertilizer of Orchids book edition was 1862, but the moth was discovered on 41 years later, and this photograph was taken after 140 years. So what is the flower and moth has to do with cybersecurity or cybercrime or a career with cybersecurity over here? What's the catch over here? So the catch over here is Charles Darwin could think something what happened after 41 years. What happened after 140 years? So I am not telling you to think what will happen after 100 years. I'm just telling you to think what will happen after maybe 40 days. What will happen after 40 months? You know, every phone, you know, I get a new phone over here. After 6 months, I have an urge to change my phone again. I get a laptop, and then again after 2 years, I want to change my laptop. You know, every day there's a new release. There's a new technology coming in. So here now, if you want to be in the field of cybersecurity, you have to think what's going to happen tomorrow. You don't have to think what's going to happen, what is happening and what I need to do. You have to think that what will happen in the future. Earlier, it was a reactive approach. There's already an incident, there's always already a hack, and then I have to react to it. Who did it? How did it? This and that. So that was a reactive approach. Later came the proactive approach. Something is going to happen and how do I work about it? So reactive approach is outdated now. Proactive approach is also not going to work. Now you have to be in a predictive mode. You have to predict what is going to happen. So reactive approach, proactive approach, is a game of the past. Now, to survive in the market, you have to be think predictive. You know, this may happen. We have to do this. That may happen. I need to design this. So, you know, in 1 hour session, maybe if I speak for 30 minutes, in 30 minutes, I cannot make you cybersecurity experts, or I cannot make you a cybercrime investigator or an analyst. But in 30 minutes, I can just make you think how you need to think, what kind of approach you need to have, what should be your attitude in your future. You know, there is an attitudinal gap between the university freshers and the industrial experts. So how do you bridge that gap? Where is that? How is that gap been filled? So, you know, you just have to think in a predictive way, reactive, proactive, and predictive approach. So now we have been speaking of cybersecurity. Coming to my career, so you know, when I was in my third year of my BTech, you have your internships. You know, just now Rashmi was telling she has been selected for Google. Congratulations, Rashmi. But then in my time, I just told you I am just a mediocre student, very average. So I didn't have good grades. I knew any corporate company may not hire me because I'm very poor in coding. I had poor marks, so I had to use my brain. I have to think out of the box. I have to think. I know I don't want to get stuck in the rat race. So what I had to do was like, I am not working out in the corporate world. So I started approaching. I started making a list of agencies, government agencies. I listed out CBI, CID, National Police Academy, who can give me an internship in government, where I can go and work into cyber forensic. Maybe there are a lot of cases coming up where you need to analyze the mobile phones, you have to do call data record analysis, you get tower dumps and you have to analyze on the dumps, your digital forensic, you have to crack passwords on mobile phones. And all these things may not need a lot of coding, they just need your presence of mind, they just need usage of tools or a bit of psychology, technology and all. So then I approached National Police Academy. The officer there asked me, you know, how do you come over there? You are a civilian, you're a student, this is a restricted area, you're not supposed to enter here, how did you manage? Then I had to convince him. So I come from a technical background, you all come from law background, why don't we collaborate with each other? No, he was very, he just asked me, he was DIG then, Deputy Inspector General, how do you think, what will I get out of it? I said, you are getting technical people working for you. And then he asked, what are you getting out of me? I said, I am just expecting a certificate where you just say that I have worked with you and you like the work is satisfactory. And that is how I got my first internship with National Police Academy. It's a place where IPS officers are trained. You know, after you clear your civil service, officer trainees come for 2 years of training. 1 year is in the National Police Academy, which is situated in Hyderabad. Like your IAS officers go to Labasna, Mussoorie, Lal Bahadur Shastri Institute, Administrative Institute Academy, and Labasna, and IPS officers come to NPA, and 1 year within the class training where, you know, they have subjects, 15 subjects, ICT, IPC, CRPC, forensic, cyber forensic, a lot of physical map reading, a lot of things. And so there I approached them. I got my internship. I used to work in the digital crime lab over there where we train officers in cyber forensic. After that, I got my M.Tech, and there I got my project in CID, Crime Investigation Department. The same thing, you know, I just had to convince the SP over there, you know, I will work, I will come with lots of technology. And I was working with the operations team over there. So cyber forensic there also, you have a great future, you know, whatever is visible over here is just the bug. And this is also data, but this is cyber forensic. So you might be aware of metadata. What is metadata? It is data about the data. So what happens, you know, I'll tell you a simple case. You know, the Naxal hit areas, your parts of Chhattisgarh, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Madhya Pradesh, Orissa. So there was a television channel. The journalist said that 7 days he has spent with Naxals. He had eaten with them. He has cooked food with them. He had roamed in the jungles with them. He was trying to prove that Naxals are also normal people just like you and me, but they have certain things, the government should take care of them. A complete footage on that particular news channel, just how the journalist has spent his time with the journalists. The investigating officer, simple, he just walked into to that media room and they asked, we are from investigation department. We just don't want anything. The just the photos, clippages, clips which have been telecasted in your channel. Can we get those clips? We just have to look at them. So without hesitation, they just gave it. And all the Naxals, you know, they cover their faces and also they without hesitation, they pass it on to the clips. The police over there, they just analyze the metadata. The metadata would say the make and model of the camera, the date taken, the GPS location. So then what happened with the GPS location of the photos taken by that journalist, they could track the complete location of the Naxal. And then there was an operation maybe after a week of preparation. So with just those photographs, they could track the complete location of those Naxals and the map, and they could have a successful operation. So here, you know, all the photos you share, all the data, you know, metadata is something, you know, you don't have to be very tech. You just have to look at the metadata and have a look. Maybe you are just copying your project from someone else and submitting your teacher. Your teacher don't have to be a forensic expert. Your professor just can look at the metadata and find out from whose laptop it came, what is the date of creation, make of creation. So forensic is also a very happening field where you can become an investigator. You don't have to come in the government field. You don't have to work with the government. Or if you're interested, you have Center of Forensic Science Laboratories, your state forensic laboratories. Now, even private companies are coming up with forensic where, you know, the corporates, like I work for a corporate or people in the corporate, they just don't want to pull their employees or pull things to legal and get it into notaries. They just want to sort of things internally. So forensic is one such field over here. Now you have digital forensic, network forensic, mobile forensic. So mobile forensic, you know, mobile is a body part. It's our body part. Everyone is, it's a new body part. It's always there with us and it has to be always with us. It's just like of evolution of humankind. Excuse me. Just evolution of humankind. Mobile is a body part. So you have mobile forensic experts, you know, every data which is there in your phone, every your photos or your contacts, your calendars, your videos, everything what you delete from your phone is not deleted. The word delete is a myth. Everything can be retrieved back. So if you're deleting something, you know that it can be retrieved by tools and all. So you have to make sure you wipe off your data. You know, the bigger, the smarter the phone is, the more vulnerable your data becomes. You all might be having smartphone. Way back in your school, you might be learning in fifth and sixth standard when first computer were introduced. You know, we had these definitions of a computer and what is the input device, output device, what is a supercomputer. So the configuration of a supercomputer, what you have studied way back in your school, now your smartphone is double the speed of it or double the storage of it. So now maybe 5 years back, what is a supercomputer is a smartphone now in your with everyone of us. So that is how forensic is, network forensic. We have again a lot of tools where you can also come up with your own tools. You know, I just ask, you know, you have to come up with ideas and create your own tools or do something. There's a lot of scope in the field of cyber security, cyber forensic, and people are looking for those young minds who think something new. There are a lot of competitions coming up. There are a lot of companies who have this bug bounty. I just want all of you to take part in those bug bounties and win money. You know, they are not very tough or it's a rocket science. You just have to sit and that dedication, and it's all about self-learning. When I got my first job, or even now, you know, you might see I don't have any certifications done. You know, people generally come up with me, what is the best internship or what is the best certification. You cybersecurity is a field where you don't have to come up with a certification. You can start with your self-learning. You can start with self-exploring, and you can do a lot of things in the field. This is digital forensic. I'll just skip it off. This is my phone number, my email ID. You can always drop a message in case you need any assistance or any doubts. You can always catch me up. I'll just open up the session for question and answers. I've already delayed a lot. I'll just open it up for question and answers. Yeah. Any queries, any questions?
Hello, ma'am. ma'am. I guess there are no questions. The session was very nice, but then there are no questions. Hello, am I audible? Yeah, actually.
Yeah, we can hear you, Rashmi.
The cases were so mind-boggling, like things that we take for granted, like chatting on WhatsApp or browsing our data and not clearing it and feeling that incognito mode is safe. And like, I know, I guess everyone after watching your session would be more concerned and will be more aware of things, you know, that we do actually very casually. So that was a very great session. Thank you so much, ma'am, for sparing your time to interact with us. And there was a lot to learn from you and from your experiences. And it really inspired me, actually, and made me more interested in this field. Though I don't have any knowledge in this field, but then thank you so much.
Thank you, Rashmi. Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Yeah. That's all. And thank you everyone for joining in. And though it's a wrap for today, but then there are more sessions aligned for tomorrow in the Hour of Code. So make sure you go and subscribe to our channel and also hit the bell button so that you get notified whenever we come live. Thank you so much and bye.
Bye-bye.